Wonderful. So I think, you know, we started yesterday with pretty macro level, and today I think we want to end up with looking outside of the core provider data question more. What we can do outside, and we have three amazing companies who are leading the way in many ways in innovation. We have Stephanie from Vida Health. So we'll do a quick demo on what they do. We're going to have Daniel from DrChrono. They are basically first mobile first EMR, and they have taken the market by storm over the last 8 years. And we have Vincent from Lyft. And you might ask, why the heck is Lyft going to be here in a healthcare event? So we're going to talk about with all of these guys and learn more what they do. Daniel and Vincent, please come here already. So we can start, but you know, while Stefan is putting up, please give a quick summary who you are, where you come from.
Sure.
And then
okay, I'll start with the intro. Thank you for having me here today. Stephanie Tilenius and founder of Vida, founder and CEO of Vida Health. We are a horizontal platform that has created a bundled digital therapeutics. So for chronic conditions like diabetes, hypertension, sleep apnea, depression, a myriad of different conditions, combined with health coaching, combined with AI and chatbots. So we have a machine learning backend that personalizes the experience. And we've had really good outcomes. We're working with employers, payers, and providers. And we've been able to take people off all their medication and reverse, take A1C from something like above an 8 to below a 6. We've taken people off hypertension meds, cholesterol meds. So having a really big impact. Employers are rolling us out to their populations, and then payers are targeting Medicare as well as self-insured and fully insured populations. We're working with Partners Healthcare, and so on the provider side, we're working with Partners Healthcare in Boston, Aurora, MD Anderson, Duke, Stanford. So I would say our provider business is the smallest part of our business, but we are getting traction where doctors are referring us as a solution for their patients. So I'll just give a brief demo. I'm going to demo a real live individual. We've changed his name for HIPAA compliance. His name in this demo is Bob. He works for actually one of our employers. He has hypertension, diabetes, arthritis, and depression, and I'm going to show you his experience with Vida. Hopefully you can see this. Okay, so this is Bob. So he's downloaded the app on his phone. He's going to pre-fill. We're going to pre-fill. We have all his information from the employer, so we pre-fill it. We ask him what his goals are. Now, he has diabetes, but his goals that he checks are to manage weight and reduce stress. We ask him what conditions he has, diabetes, hypertension, and high blood pressure and depression. We ask if he's taking any oral meds. He is. Whether he's on insulin, he's not. And then we use an algorithm where we take all his data from his biometric screen from his employer, which we administer, and we put him into a diabetes management program. This is a 16-week intensive program with video consultation with a diabetes educator every week, as well as programmatic, actionable things that he needs to do every day. And then after 16 weeks, it moves into more of a monthly program, but it's a year long, and we measure his A1C at 6 months and then at 12 months. After we match him to a program, we're going to ask him what times he's available for consultation and what kind of coach personality he's looking for, because you know, we want to make sure we match with the right person. And then we use another algorithm. We use over 30 to 40 different variables here, where we're looking at all his demographics, his health goals, and we are showing him 5 different coaches from our network, and then he can choose his coach. We book an appointment right then. We ask him when he's available. We've already limited the set based on his previous answer. And then we import his biometric screen. You can see he has an 8.9 A1C. And then we get him started. So he's in a chat feed right now. This is like Facebook Messenger, though it's a separate app with a HIPAA compliant experience. And he's talking to Jennifer. She's online. She's welcoming him to Vida. She asks if he has time to do a quick video consult. We tend to have a video consult in the first 48 hours for most of our customers. She's welcoming him, explaining how they're going to be working together. And she has all his data. On the back end, she has a dashboard where she can see pretty much everything about Bob. She follows up with messages after that. She can also act as a concierge, like if he needs an optometrist appointment for a diabetes checkup, things like that. In the Today tab, we connected his devices, and these are the things he's working on with Jennifer. He'll track some things like food in the app, but other things will be passively tracked. So we'll connect to his glucometer. We connect to about 59 of them. We'll connect to his blood pressure cuff, other things like that. So you can see the conversation. She'll ask him to set his goal. His goal was to lose 30 pounds. He actually lost 33 pounds. It are lessons that come up. So he's being welcomed into the diabetes management program. We explain it, 16 weeks plus 8 months. I know there's other people, so I'm gonna quickly go through this, but you get a sense of, we ask them to commit to weigh themselves. We ask for commitment to activity. We're asking for commitment to reading lessons, to engaging with their coach. So we get them started, and this is what a lesson would look like. And then along the way, we have something called the Journey tab where he can see his progress. And this is behavioral science driven. So on the back end, what we're doing is looking at the drivers of his success. We have a knowledge graph where we know what drives outcomes. And so we're looking for him. This is a personalized view at his medication adherence to his hypertension meds, his nutrition, his activity, and we're tracking his success along the way. Now, at the same time, Bob does have depression, and he texts his coach saying he's had unusually exacerbated depression and stress. So he's asking for help, and so Coach Jennifer will connect him to a therapist. You can see that there's a coach and a therapist there. So he switches to a separate feed. It's entirely private with the coach. And then they're going back and forth, and he has he's enrolled in a 12-week cognitive behavioral therapy program similar to diabetes. And so then over time, what happens is we track his lifestyle factors. I'm trying to juggle both the... and we look at his condition risk, and we look at his lab results over time, right? And we report this back all to the physician, so we have a PDF that drops back into Epic. So over time, what happened is about 9 months, Bob lost 33 pounds. He lowered his A1C from 8.9 to 6.3, went off all his meds, and his productivity went up. So that's how Vida works. Thank you.
Hey, thank you so much. It's really, really impressive to see the progress that you've been able to make in a few years on this. And I mean, every demo I see, it looks better. So come on, sit in here. Daniel, you can set up your device. And one question, you know, while Daniel's setting up. So, Stephanie, you have a really unique background in a way that, you know, we talked about the shopping experience, and you spent time at eBay, PayPal, and Google, and in many ways working on that experience. So could you talk about that a bit? Like, what did you learn in being in the forefront of innovation in these tech companies when you are now doing it in healthcare?
There's so many lessons. I would say that you have to focus on the consumer first and foremost, no matter what part of healthcare you're in, whether it's a payer, provider, any channel. It's all about the consumer. We sell into B2B2C, right? So we sell into employers, payers, and providers, but at the end of the day, the customer is all the same. So the consumer experience is really important, and I think a lot of healthcare companies don't prioritize that. The other thing I would say about the industry is, and I don't mean this to be offensive, but like it's partly my internalization and learning. So at Google, when I was there, and it's kind of fun to be back here, if you didn't innovate, you would die. Like, I mean, that's how I lived every day. Like, if I didn't break something, test something new, build a prototype, push the boundaries, I was gonna die. In healthcare, it's the opposite. it feels like if we push too far, if we innovate, you die, because there's fear about the patient, there's fear about HIPAA, there's, but I find that there's a lot of irrational fear, a ton of irrational fear. And, you know, consumers are like taking pictures of their data in MyChart and giving it to us. They don't care about privacy. They want a solution to their problem. And so I think we need to really be proactive as an industry and really think about how do we provide the best services to consumers. And we, of course, we need to protect their data, but they want the same thing they're getting from Amazon and Google. They really do.
Cool, thank you. Go ahead, Daniel.
All right, I have about 5 minutes, so I'm gonna be pretty quick with my slides. Let me just ask you guys a couple of questions. How many of you guys have insurance cards on you right now? Raise your hand. How many of you guys have physical insurance cards on you right now? Do any of you guys have your insurance cards on your phone? A couple of you guys, okay. How many people here have a personalized, a medical record on their phone? Raise your hand. A couple of you guys, okay. Well, DrChrono, we are a medical records company. I'm going to go into a couple of things. I'm going to fly really fast through these slides. I got a lot of slides. So the practice of the future, what does that look like for a physician? And I'm kind of changing things around for you guys where we're looking at the provider, the professional physician who's actually taking care of all of us. So in the past, physicians were able to actually take a bag in the, you know, the 1800s and literally walk to someone's house and be able to actually take care of them. Now we're set up like this, where there's these massive infrastructures, and with those infrastructures comes a lot of actual silos. So there's a lot of actual data silos out there where data is actually not being transferred between healthcare institutions in a good way. So one of the secrets that I've seen is that the whole healthcare system, you know, everybody is faxing something to somebody. So there's a lot of faxing going on in the industry. We've had physicians come into our office frustrated because they deal with paper all day. They feel like they're actual glorified, like, secretaries. And really, there's like two things that physicians have to do. They only have a little bit of time with you, and they want to take as best care of you as possible. So there's this continual time limit when they're seeing rapid successions of patients. So the industry is moving towards something called a cow. How many people here know what a cow is? Not this type of cow, but this type of cow. Computer on wheels. So the industry is actually moving towards this. Here's an actual screenshot of a bunch of cows laid out. Physicians actually can't really move around that much with these devices. So the mission of our company really is to kill the cow. This is the modern physician of the future. They're going to be able to get up, go wherever they want to go, and actually take care of a patient. Here's an actual screenshot from Instagram of one of the physicians from DrChrono who actually was using an iPad projecting it while he was doing a surgery. So tech should really serve the provider and not really the other way around. So how do we fix this problem? One, we need to move to the cloud. Everything kind of needs to be digital. And the design has to be good. So I'm gonna just fly through some slides. This is we are a Silicon Valley company, so I'll give you guys a fun quick story. And then I'm gonna give you a quick demo of iPhone X. Company was started in 2009. Me and my co-founder met in college. There's us, and first investor actually was the founder of Reddit. He actually believed in our company, convinced us to move out to Silicon Valley, got into Y Combinator, and this is an interesting slide where I see innovation happening so quickly. So there's a lot of electronic health record companies out there, and they do yearly release cycles. I'll talk to some of these vendors, and they'll say, hey, you know, we do our yearly release cycle. The industry is moving too fast for that, so I kind of see it like Warren Buffett does. If you have compounding interest, the interest makes you more money quicker. So if you think about like the future of like healthcare, you need everything in the cloud so you have compound coding. So, you know, our EHR is continually releasing every single day new code as new devices like the iPhone 10 come out. Here's our company, 2015. We have 10 million patients in our software today. 10 million, so that's roughly 3% of the US population. We're booking, well, actually, how many patient bookings are there? According to the CDC, there's about a little under a billion patient appointments happening in the US. So DrChrono, we're booking around 800,000 appointments per month, 1% of the US population. We were the first on the iPad, first electronic health record on the iPad. So people said that there's things coming out called the iPad. Steve Jobs announced it, the lines were there. We were there day one on the iPad. It was us and very few other vendors. So if you think about EHRs, how do they get to this device faster? Here's us day one, here's us today. That's the whole solution, the suite that we actually have built out. And we're thinking about simple design, of course. Fun photo, we're actually official partners with Apple in their mobility program. So the practice of the future is going to be something that's very, very elegant, right? A wearable health record on your wrist, your iPhone in your pocket. Physicians will be able to chart and go anywhere that they want. I'm going to fly through these slides. Let me give you guys, I don't want to take too much time. I'm just going to give you guys the iPhone X demo. I don't have one on me. We have one at our office. And what's exciting is last week, we were the first electronic health record to actually do a login with Face ID. So if you think about it, physicians go into the room, they type in to the keyboard to log in. That's the first experience you have with a physician when you're dealing with them and that cow. And if they have 10 minutes with you or 15 minutes with you, and they need to log in 20 seconds, 15 seconds, 90 seconds, they forget their username and password, and they're sitting there for like a minute sometimes. So here's actually our app. A physician can look at their phone, and it just logs them in. So if you think about that, if they're going room to room and they have to see 30 patients, how fast and awesome is that? We've been doing tests at our office. We launched it day one when the iPhone 10 came out. It was in CNBC last week. Here's the actual video of one of our employees actually doing it. So literally, he just launches the app and you're into the medical record. Think of how awesome that is. And think about it from the patient side as well. You get some patients who forget their username, right? You log in once a year, you get a healthy patient who never logs in. If they can log into their medical record without actually remembering a username and password, they can get right in. Awesome. Thank you, guys.
Hey, that's awesome. So, Vincent, no slides, but please tell us why Lyft is here.
Yeah, sure. Hi, everybody. So, my name is Vince Reyes. I'm with Lyft. Vincentlyft.com if there's an opportunity to connect. So my role is I lead the partnerships programs, the team that builds partnerships programs with government, education, and most recently healthcare. So what I'd like to do is take 5 minutes as well. It'll just be me, and I just want to share with you high level what we're doing at Lyft, and then what we're doing specifically in healthcare. So this topic might be a little bit different than some of what you've engaged with throughout the day, but ultimately it's leveraging the smartphone. Or in our case, leveraging a concierge platform to book rides for people that these organizations care for. So let me just start very quickly. The car is the average American's second largest household expense, $9,000 a year. I think some of you work in technology, so we think about the cloud model, and I was talking to Ari. We are basically on-demand transportation, right? So we provide an alternative to car ownership is what part of what our mission is, our founder's mission. So this $9,000 expense a year is used primarily 4%, on average 4% of the time. So there's lots of chatter. You've probably seen some press with regards to what's happening in the car industry. In fact, when General Motors, their president invested, GM invested $500 million in the beginning of 2016, his comment was there'll be more change in this automotive space between 16 and 2021 than there have been in the previous 50 years. And I think we're seeing a lot of that start to unfold now with all the news, all the chatter. So our founders got together in 2007, actually started their first company called Zimride for colleges, universities, to share rides home for kids for the long weekend, want to pair up so they can go home from Berkeley to Truckee, for example, and share that ride. But in 2012, our founders had to create and update the app for the smartphone, and chose to open it up to the consumer, what we know Lyft does today. There's a handful of reasons, a number of reasons why folks choose to partner with us. I'll call out. There's safety reasons. There's collaboration in how we work with our partners, whether it's with regulators, throughout the country, partners. We started with Apple as our first corporate client, and in healthcare, I'll talk about some of our use cases. But there's a broker company called NatMed Trans out in the East Coast that we created this solution for. Our founders put this together. We introduced it. We created a team specifically for healthcare, this NatMed Trans. We knew that there was a problem that we can help solve in curb-to-curb rides. Now, we know that that's not all the types of rides that brokers will give or folks will need to go to pay a visit to the hospital or to the doctor's office. But non-emergency medical rides, it's about 3.5 million rides that are missed on an annual basis because they don't have transportation. So we took this model with NatMed Trans, and now we've partnered with LogistiCare. We've partnered with Ascension, the largest private hospital system. We're working on things with electronic medical records with organizations so that Lyft can be an option, so that rides can be booked, with API built into the app. We've got use cases for what I mentioned with non-emergency medical transportation, but also patient flow. So with Ascension, for example, when a patient is ready to go, it's an option for folks to hail a Lyft ride for that person. Also clinical trials, a big part of the success of the trials is that folks actually show up to their appointments. So the sponsor companies are paying for these rides for those patients. That gives you a high level of some of what we're doing. As far as adoption goes, we're in all 50 states. 95% of Americans can get a Lyft ride. Lots of growth happened this year. When I started a couple years ago, we were doing about 1 million rides every 7 days. We're now doing better than that every day. So there's just tremendous growth, and the consumer is what's driving what's happening in the healthcare space. The one thing I want to point out, we are a mission-driven company, improve people's lives with the world's best transportation. I had a brain freeze in the middle of what I was sharing with you, but I want to make sure I bring out one of the reasons why folks partner with us is with brand alignment. Our values, we have values that we plaster throughout the office. It's around diversity and inclusion, so make it happen, create fearlessly uplift others, be yourself. But the other thing is our climate impact goals, so we put a stake in the ground. All the autonomous work that we do that's on our platform is going to be 100% renewable energy. We're going to do better than 1 billion rides by the year 2025, and lower greenhouse gas emissions by 5 million pounds every year. So we put that stake in the ground. And lastly, it's corporate social responsibility. It's exciting and it's wonderful to meet with folks we haven't met with in organizations, and just them sharing their alignment. Our alignment together with brand and has been a real has been a reason why folks have chosen to partner with us versus others in the space. So hopefully that gives you an idea of what it is that we're doing. Hopefully I explain so it makes sense. But feel free to ask any questions.
Cool, wonderful. Hey, come on. First question about mobile. So all these companies are mobile first, and I think two of the companies couldn't really exist without the smartphone. So what do you think healthcare companies, health plans, health systems could learn from the mobile first approach that you have taken?
Sure, I guess I'll start off. One of the things I think that insurance companies can definitely leverage is, you know, for me, I think I have a phone number. And the phone number, I have to call it and say, is this covered a lot of the time? Talking at, from the patient perspective, you know, there's almost this, you don't really know your insurance company. You don't know what you're covered for. You don't know, you know, your information on what anything about your insurance. I get emails from my insurance company. I don't read them, but I'm always, I always have my phone. Right, and there are moments when I want to know, am I covered for a lab checkup, right? Right, so I think I'm in my car and I realize, huh, I didn't go to my doctor this year, let me get my physical checkup. Then your physician will say, hey, did you get, go down the hall and get your labs. And you might have, it might have, you know, those times when you're not sure if it's been a year or not, I think, from the patient perspective, it's really valuable to be able to build something very native that you can interact with that insurance company. You know, flip it for the doctor. We're doing that for the doctors. We really focus on that experience for them and say, how does a doctor, you know, get information and put information in as fast as possible?
Anybody want to guess what percent of United Healthcare's member they have an email for or a text message, a text number, a phone number for? Guess. 72%, 30%, right? So, you know, they have, any of these large payers have what they call transactional emails and marketing emails. Their entire form of communication is outdated. So think about what, Danielle just said. I mean, it's all about being contextually relevant to you, right, at the time that you want it. So many people who get outreach from an insurance company today, they don't pay attention to it. They get an EOB at home in their mail, not really exciting. They get a call from a nurse at 7 o'clock at home at night while they're eating dinner with their family. They don't want to talk to the nurse at that time. So I think mobile is a complete 180-degree flip a switch, think about talking to the person when they want to be communicated with, when it's contextually relevant, when it's convenient, and it fits into their life, and then you're going to get a much better response. So that's what we're doing.
So as far as Lyft goes for the consumer, we need a smartphone. However, for those use cases that I mentioned in hospitals, for example, we have this concierge platform where folks are able to dispatch rides on behalf of a third party. So I don't know if I have any additional information to add other than when 12 came around, 2012, we had to update our app. We had to update it because we had to get in line with where the technology was with the iPhone, for example.
What about then another point that we've been hearing a lot about, which is the data? Not only the provider data, but overall that data is becoming the key value in companies. That becomes the thing that we are measured against. So I think all the companies that you work are really based on the data. How do you visualize the data? How do you get the data collected better? So talk about the data aspect a little bit. How do you see the market going forward now? Because the challenge is that we have more and more data in healthcare every day, and I think we have a really hard time making that data usable or taking any making even sense of the data what we have as organizations.
Sure. I think DrChrono, we have a massive data set and we have a lot of physicians using our software. And doctors go to school to become doctors. They're not going to school to become billers, learn coding. So for us, one of the things we're working on is trying to give insights to the physician if they are doing something that is not helping them get paid faster, right? So part of what we do is we actually submit medical claims to the insurance companies, And physicians have a fee schedule, which is basically like, I do this, I get paid for this. I do this, I get paid for this. Where do they get those fee schedules? They learn it over time. They learn it from other people. They learn it from Medicare, Medicaid. They learn it from insurance companies, but it might not be right, right? So if you can take those data sets and figure out what is the optimal way to get a doctor paid, and the insurance company is okay with that, I think that's an interesting thing for us, because that brings value to the doctor where they can actually take care of the patient. You know, you have large organizations like hospitals, they have billing teams, coding teams, they're hiring massive amounts of people there. Same problem, right? But if it's people, you should have also software figuring some of those problems out, maybe machine learning.
You know, I think each of the different constituents in healthcare uses the data they have. So providers use EMR data, payers use claims data. A lot of the data that we're capturing is behavioral and phenotypic data that isn't really captured today. And so we're trying to use it to look at how would one type of diabetic respond to the treatment versus another. And we're trying to create different pathways. So you think about diabetes 2, there's probably like 10 or 12 different types of that disease, right? Whether it's largely lifestyle inflicted, how far along you've had it, whether you're on insulin or metformin, there's so many different permutations. And we don't really have good data today on the consumer behavior patterns that are driving the disease. And so we're trying to capture that, use the data to provide insights and help people manage and overcome their condition.
So as far as data goes with folks that use the Lyft platform, so first of all, there is some basic reporting so folks can see impacts on cost, and there's a set of data that's set to our clients. There are also studies that are done, right? So it's very important to quantify the impact that an offering like Lyft can have. So I'll give you a few examples. So Blue Cross Blue Shield, we just partnered with them, and we're in the process of doing a study of social determinants of health for folks that live in where it's difficult to get public transportation. So seeing the impact of being able to take non-emergency medical rides with Lyft and seeing how that impacts that population. We also, we were in Stanford, I'll say about a month ago, where we announced a partnership with AARP, United Healthcare, where there's a study. I'm gonna screw up the stat, but it was something like, women in particular stop driving or stop that whole social interaction. There's just, I wanna say 9 years when there's, it might be lifespan. So there's this notion that being able to, even though one's not driving, to be able to get around to where they need to go to maintain and be a part of community. So another use case with us is with elder communities. Brookdale is the largest community that we in the country, and we partner with them, is to provide these folks, elders, the ability to reconnect with communities. There's other studies as well. But that's how the data comes to life. Caremore, one more in SoCal, they did a study with JAMA that shows 32% better performance with rides using Lyft and 30% impact on cost. So it's great to have that data to back it, these studies to help support what we're pushing.
So one more stab on Vince on the data point. So you said million rides a day, right? Okay, so they do 350 million roughly rides a year, one company. We had how many visits per year for doctors? 990 million. So a third of all the healthcare visits this one company is doing, and every Lyft ride is kind of like an appointment. So how do you handle that? And how what could we learn from that data science effort you do in healthcare?
And how long it takes on average to get the ride?
Yeah, so unfortunately I can't comment on the data science piece just because that's something that some others with at HQ would be able to better address. Specifically with ETAs, it'll range. So we're in all 50 states, so it'll vary by market. But typically, it'll be 3 minutes, 2 to 3 minutes. But then there are certain areas where it'll be longer than that, depending on where it is. The other thing with regards to as far as rides go, so we're doing tens of thousands of rides. On a weekly basis, specifically in this healthcare space. But we are very much in the infancy. We're just at the start. So the consumer, if you're tracking ride sharing, is the hockey stick. Like the adoption in the consumer space is just very, very fast relative to some other technologies. So we're following that. We're behind it, but we're still, it's just 0.4% of vehicle miles traveled is happening in this rideshare way. So 0.4% of all rides. So in other words, we're very much in the infancy as well, even though we're experiencing this type of growth. What I can also share with you, we didn't know all the opportunity that was out there a couple of years ago when we started I'm on the Lyft business part of the business, the B2B part of Lyft. We're very much in the infancy of all of this.
We had a couple of questions today in different discussions already around how could we do better with provider data by using not only collecting data, using our directories, using our public data source. But we also mentioned things like claims data and then EMRs a couple times. So Daniel, how would you think this audience here could help, or how could you help us to make the provider data more accurate by utilizing maybe data you are collecting on a daily basis?
So to understand the question, how do we make the provider data more?
So how do we make it more accurate, timely, and by using data sources other than what we have in this room, which are more collecting from the providers, from the health systems?
Well, we have one practice. The practice has around 80 users, and I'll give you one example that might be useful. And this is a plug for BetterDoctor, where this group, we have an address book, essentially, and it's a shared address book, and people are entering data in all sorts of ways in this address book. And it's for a practice. And I don't know if I'm answering your question directly, but data can get messy, right? Like, the address book clearly is messy, and, you know, medical records, you know, people say, you know, how do you detect if one institution's medical record is the same as another's, and it's the same patient? Which one is which? And I think, you know, it's the same thing with providers, right? If someone types in John Smith and another person types in J. Smith, another person types in J. period Smith, medical record or address book, it's the same issue. That's one thing, you know, how do you detect that patient is that patient across many, many institutions? You know, one thing that I hear a lot about is enrollments, and credentialing that provider. I definitely think that's something where there's something there. I think there's something that could be done there, like enrolling and credentialing providers quicker. You know, whenever we talk to a provider and they want to use our software, they're like, how do we get paid as fast as possible? Well, there's this whole process. Do you guys all know enrollments and credentialing? Some people. It's basically just like connecting that doctor to that insurance company and making sure that they can get paid on the claims as fast as possible. So it's almost like a race. They buy our software, and then we aggressively have to get the information to the insurance company as fast as possible. And if anything goes wrong, the doctor's not going to be happy, right? Because they're seeing patients, they're entering data into our EHR. We do handle the credentialing and the enrollments. So I think, you know, if you guys had an awesome system for like an API that could just, boom, we could just display everything in an amazing way, that would be awesome. You know, that's one thing that would make doctors' lives easier. Because like, things expire, they might add a new insurance company from a new patient, you know, things get messy. And, you know, how do we make that better for them? That's one thing. I don't know if that answers the question exactly, but you know, it's a black box for providers. You know, they go to medical school, they get into massive amounts of debt, they're under massive amounts of pressure, they go out, they start practicing at some place, and they learn what they learn, and then they go off and they start their own practice a lot of the time, and then they're doing what they're doing, and giving them more insights as an organization would, you know, they probably want you to work with that insurance company. They're like, hey, this one insurance company, and they'll tell us, they'll be like, hey, this one insurance company is great. They pay us, you know, and they're paying and they're doing, you know, we get that insight from them, and that's them telling us they're, you know, they're not having this back and forth, like, how do I get paid from this insurance company, so.
Do you do your own credentialing, or do you outsource? Do you actually do the credentialing, or do you source the data to a credentialing entity?
We have a credentialing team. So when a doctor decides to buy our EHR, we're an ambulatory outpatient EHR, we're not an inpatient EHR. So we have providers that are outside the hospital. They will buy our software, and then we start the process to, depends, if they want to do billing through us. So we provide an EHR, practice management billing, kind of, if they just want an EHR, that's fine. But then if they want billing, that's where you got to get into the credentialing side, and then that team starts to kick everything off. And that's where things can get messy if communication isn't aggressive towards the insurance company. We got to make sure that all the paperwork is submitted. We got to make sure like everything is there so that doctor can get paid when like submitting claims. And it's an incentive for you guys. Like the quicker and the more communication that there is going on, they'll just see more patients, right? And they'll rely on your insurance companies more.
Cool, thank you. What about then, if you think about the healthcare on a macro level, and you all have a unique viewpoint into the market, so what do you think are the biggest opportunities today that should be fixed? What are a few things that you think today are causing a havoc that, you know, we could probably solve, or we have to solve?
Well, systematically, data interoperability, right? I think that the other problem that, and this is a macro problem that is hard to solve, but there is this like giant hairball of perverse incentives in healthcare. So as a consumer, unless I'm on a high deductible plan, I really don't have a reason to optimize. Like, let's say you give me tools from Castlight or BookMD or any of these tools, BetterDoctor, and I really don't have an incentive to go to the lowest cost MRI, because unless you're, even if you give me a bonus for doing that, when I'm sick and I'm not feeling well, I'm going to go to the doctor that I hear nearby. And like, we're working with employers, and they say to us all the time, well, we have grand rounds, we have second opinions, but people may not use it. They may not seek a second opinion. How do you get them to seek a second opinion, right? Like, people should be seeking a second opinion. Like, everyone in this room that is smart and intelligent in the system would seek a second opinion, right? You would all do it. How do we get the general population to do these things? And so there is this really this giant hairball of just like, if you were, like, think about if you were buying a TV, you would research every option. You would know every detail of every TV screen, right? Like, and people spend so much time on their clothes and their iPhones and their cars and like, but not on their healthcare, right? So how do you solve it? Well, do you make people accountable? Like, how do we change the system so that people are really accountable? And I don't have any easy answers for that, but I think we need to reinvent health insurance. Medicare Advantage seems to be an area that is ripe for change because of that, because people buy it out of pocket more than anything else. And so you're seeing like Clover and other, you know, Medicare Advantage plans stand up and then doing it a different way. But I really think we need to think systematically about new like everyone talks about value-based care. We should all be in a value-based care model, but it's moving slowly, right?
I mean, so we are, you said reinvent. So we're reinventing another option, an alternative option to get to appointments. You know, regulation, so we are in 41, if not just a little over 41 states where there's regulation established for the entire state, but also as it relates to Medicare, Medicaid, it's a new option, and it's forcing new conversations to happen on you know, how we're able to provide rides for folks that are under these programs. So, you know, I think, again, because this is new, it's forcing organizations to have conversations they haven't had to have in decades, specifically with transportation.
And just on that note, like, CareMore did a great job, yes, actually offering rides well before anybody else did. It's a great thing that all the health plans should look at social determinants and lower their costs that way, right?
Yeah, I think since this is an insurance event, you know, I had to get, this is my insurance card on my iPhone. I had to get, there was another developer company that worked with someone who provided us the health insurance who got this on my phone, right? It should be you guys. Like, you guys, if we want to make healthcare better, you know, how do I know if I'm covered for, like, a CPAP machine, right, or a sleep study? I have to call, like, and it takes hours, and it's confusing, and, you know, I do have this on my phone, and there's a mind shift. It's going to take time. Like, I gave this to someone at a clinic, and they said, oh, no, I need the physical card. I'm going to scan it. Why? Like, I'm like, can I email it to you? I'll take a screenshot and email it to you. And they just were, they're like, well, next time you come, just give me the physical card. And I'm like, well.
I have a similar example. So I log in with Touch ID to my Epic right here, right? And I've got all my data. And I recently, I wanted to share this with a doctor. And they were like, no. Like, no, I need the actual, sorry. I actually need the report. I mean, it's the same thing.
Oh, it's not, I actually don't blame you guys. I think it's just like the industry moves slower. And, you know, how do you push the limits? Like, we launched Face ID and people think, oh my God, Face ID. You know, you get someone who's in there, you know, that's really ill. Do you think they're going to remember their username? Like, really ill, brain cancer, right? Do you think they're really going to care about logging in? But if they look at their phone and they go, oh, I'm covered. Like, and then they can maybe hand it to the provider. The provider could say, okay, you know, let me do what I gotta do. You know, I'm actually like hugely optimistic of the future of healthcare. That's why we're doing what we're doing. I actually think these things are gonna get solved. It's not gonna be perfect, but it's just gonna, it's gonna evolve and become better over time.
Thank you. And I think, you know, that's good upbeat a little bit on this. So I think, you know, one plug for Kaiser. I mean, how many Kaiser members are here? Okay, quite a few. And I mean, all of us know that, I mean, we have a pretty amazing app on our mobile phones. We can actually log in and see our records, book online, and do things that I don't think any other health plan can provide, because they're fully integrated. And as well, Stephanie, as well, your company is fully integrated in many ways, so you can do things that are almost impossible to do for any provider or any group that is doing these things, because, you know, when you do the whole thing yourself, then you can do it in much higher quality. And I think to kind of end this, I heard a lot about the data. We have to kind of liberate the data. We have to give the patient, of course, ownership on their own data. I think we were talking already today a lot about, we need to give the provider also ownership of their own provider data and so forth. But any questions from the audience? I mean, any question? These people are ready to answer, I think. Are people getting tired already? I heard some wine opening already behind me, so we are kind of between you and the wine. One question at least. I think, you know, Grand Rounds put on the spot here, so I think, you know.
Oh yeah, sorry.
Any question? Okay, no question there. So one.
And it goes to sort of real-time data. I was in a breakout session over there on the couch, and my phone lit up, and I got an alert that my credit card was being used in Georgia. So immediately I got on the phone with them, they resolved the problem. That's just a credit card. Why can't my health be like that? Why are we as an industry not ready for those kind of real time updates, whether it's a provider, whether it's personal, anything like that? And how can we get there?
was just thinking, it seems obvious, right? So the other day I had a pain in my side and I went to the clinic nearby and I had to call my doctor, and thankfully I actually have her text, so I texted her. But I was thinking, like, to your question, like, why wouldn't she just get a notification on her phone, right? Automatically, like, that I'm there, right? I don't know. I mean, we expect that in every other area, right? I mean, pretty much other have it. I mean, my understanding historically has been, like, I actually have a concierge provider out of Sutter. And I know that a lot of the pressure on the physician side has been they don't have enough time. They have like 8 minutes on average with an individual, and they don't have time to take email and so one of the reasons I moved to concierge is I can text, I can talk to them at any point. But it does seem kind of odd, right? Like, we should all expect that. Like, why don't we all have that? And I don't know what the ratio, the average primary care physician ratio is to patient. I know in a concierge it's like several thousand maybe, but I think it's like five or six. I think it's like multiples greater in a normal primary care situation. I mean, one thought is that we've been spending a lot of time thinking about this. So doctors want to practice at the top 1% of their license, and they don't want to get calls for everything, but they could get an alert. But coaches and nurses and all of the folks that we are, I mean, they can do the day-to-day continuous care of the individual at a much lower cost. And then the bots, all the AI, can automate a lot. So you think of a hierarchy, like doctors, coaches, bot, and think about how much you could take cost out of the system if we all embrace that. So,
Sure. I think, what you're saying is very accurate about like instant real time. I would love to know if I'm in, like, I walk into a place, I'm like, I hope they take my insurance. I checked it, I called them, they said yes, I hope. And then you hand them the insurance card, and they're like, yeah, you're covered. You know, we have one employee at our company who had a horrendous experience where he was out of network, and they charged him thousands of dollars, and he didn't know. He didn't know, I wish it would just tell him that, you know, you go 5 miles away and you'll save yourself $25,000. Like, it was a lot of money that was out of network, and... You know, there's so much that we can do. And I think, you know, the industry, just tackle one thing and do that really well. If you can do that, maybe it's the app. Maybe it's real-time notifications. Maybe it's paying faster than the other insurance companies. You know, whatever it is, just if your company would, like, focus on that, I don't think we can do everything. For us, we're really focusing on mobile. There's a lot to tackle. We're all doing really hard, complex things. And healthcare is one of these things that, it's daunting, you know, it's the GDP, we're like a $3 trillion industry. It's crazy, there's a lot going on.
So, just a quick question, probably off topic, but when I think about your friend, what happens is they walk in the door or they call and they say, I'll make this up, Blue Cross Blue Shield, oh yeah, we take that. But if it's a PPO plan, they do take it, but you're subject to your out-of-network. And I think that there's a partnership here with the payer and with the physicians, doctors, clinics, whatever, to say, we will take your insurance, but we are not in network. So I just had to throw that plug in because I've had that happen with my own family, where they, what did you do? And they said they took it. So just that thought in mind, right? While we have a responsibility as payers, how do we better educate consumers in the middle, but also the doctor's offices or clinics or whatever the scenario is to say, yes, we will take it. You have a PPO, but we're not on your plan. You go down the street.
But I mean, that's an example. Like you go to grocery stores now and they're automated checkouts, right?
Yes.
So when you go to a doctor's office, they should have all that information at their fingertips in the cloud, telling you, sorry, just so you know, right?
This is going to cost
you. And that's the point, right? This is going to cost you X amount. Right now, it's an individual. They don't have access to the data. It's all manual.
Right.
Like,
no,
so,
I get it. It's a partnership, though. It's bigger than just one person
or
right?
Cool. Thank you for the panel. Great discussion on this. And this is more or less a wrap. So we're going to have some wine, some food here. This is the second time we were hosting a data summit at BetterDoctor. Thank you all for coming. This is always an experiment for us. I think I hope we all learned something today. We have online videos coming up on the recordings. We're going to send a link to everybody so you can watch them yourself. You can share them with your organization. We're also going to do some notes and summarize this and send everybody a note about it. We can also ask feedback. So any feedback you have, I don't know about the Hawaii, that might not be the best idea, but other feedback, guidance, help, please tell us what we should do better. We're going to be doing more of these small events in different cities when we go around, and we're definitely going to do one more bigger one next year. So look forward for that. But thank you for coming.